¿Cómo están? Los saludo con mucho gusto. Mi nombre es Alejandro Franco y les doy la bienvenida de nueva cuenta a Sesiones, este programa acerca de proyectos musicales de varias partes del mundo que vienen y tocan aquí para nosotros de una manera muy íntima y para ustedes en donde quiera que se encuentren. El día de hoy tenemos una mujer muy interesante. Es una mujer originaria de Moscú. Después se fue a vivir a Nueva York y la verdad es que todo lo que ha ocurrido en su vida y sobre todo todo lo que ha escuchado y lo que ha estudiado de música da como resultado un proyecto muy particular. Los quiero dejar con ella, les pido un aplauso para ella, también gracias a toda la gente que asistió el día de hoy con nosotros y a ustedes que nos siguen allá, y los dejo con Regina Spektor.
Come and open up your folding chair next to me. My feet are buried in the sand, and there's a breeze. There's a shadow, you can't see my eyes. And the sea is just a wetter version of the skies. Let's get a silver bullet trailer and have a baby boy. I'll safety pin his clothes all cool and you. Of his toys, I got a perfect body, but sometimes I forget. I got a perfect body, 'cause my eyelashes catch my sweat. Yes, they do. Sitting on this abandoned beach for years, waiting for the salty water to cover up my ears. But every time of the tide come to take me home, I get scared. Now I'm sitting here alone, dreaming of the dolphin song. So down, don't make frowns, you silly clown. Just come and open up your folding chair next to me. My feet are buried in the sand, and there's a breeze. There's a shadow, you can't see my. The sea is just a wetter version of the skies. There's a shadow. It's like forgetting the words to your favorite song. You can't believe it, you were always singing along. It was so easy, and the words so sweet. You can't remember, you try to feel. Half of your life Someone's deciding whether or not to steal. He opens a window, oh, just to feel the chill. He hears that outside a small boy just started to cry. 'Cause it's his turn, but his brother won't let him try. It's like forgetting the words to your favorite song. You can't believe it. You were always singing along. It was so easy. And what so sweet? You can't remember. You try to move. Are subjointed. I live in the future. In my pre-war apartment, and I count on my blessings. I have friends in high places, and I'm upgraded today. Your power, who just lacks my perspectives, and who lacks my organics, and who covets my defects, and I'm downloaded daily. I am part of a composite. Hooked into machine, hooked into machine. consumer, part of worldly taking, apart from worldly troubles, living in your pre-war apartment, soon to be your post-war apartment, and you live in a future, and the future, it's here, it's bright, it's now. No laughs are got in a hospital. No laughs are got in a war. No one's laughing at God when they're starving or freezing or so very poor. No one laughs at God when a doctor calls after some routine tests. No one's laughing at God who's gone real late. Your kid's not back from that party yet. No one laughs at God when the airplane starts to uncontrollably shake. No one's laughing at God when they see the one they love hanging out with someone else and they hope that they're mistaken. No one laughs at God when a cop's knock on your door and they say, we got some bad news, sir. No one's laughing at God when there's a famine, fire, flood. But God could be funny at a cocktail party while listening to a good God themed joke, or when the crazy say he hates us and they get so red in the head, you think about to choke. God could be funny when Tony will give you money if you just pray the right way. And when presented like a genie, does magic like Houdini, or grants wishes like Jiminy Cricket and Santa Claus. God could be so hilarious, ha ha. God in a hospital. No one laughs at God in a war. No one's laughing at God when they've lost all they got and they don't know what for. No one laughs at God on a day they realize that the last sight they'll ever see is a pair of hateful eyes. No one's laughing at God when they're saying their goodbyes. But God could be funny at a cocktail party while listening to a good God themed joke, or when the crazy say he hates us and they get so red in the head they think about to choke. God could be funny when Tony will give you money if you just pray the right way. And when presented like a genie who does magic like Houdini, or grants wishes like Jiminy Cricket and Santa Claus. God could be so hilarious, but no one laughs at God in a hospital. No one laughs at God in a war. No one laughs at God in a hospital. No one laughs at God in a war. No one laughing at God in a hospital. No one's laughing at God in a war. No one's laughing at God when they're starving or freezing or so very poor. No one's laughing at God. No one's laughing at God. No one's laughing at God, we're all laughing with God.
Qué bueno que siguen con nosotros aquí en sesiones. Regina Spector está aquí en la casa. How are you, Regina?
I'm good, thank you.
Do you like the name in Spanish, Regina?
I like it, Regina.
Yeah? Sounds really good.
Yeah.
Well, thanks a lot for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Well, I read you're from Moscow?
Yes.
Yeah, you lived there like the first 9-10 years of your life?
Yeah, I came to New York when I was 9 and a half.
Okay, and when you were there, which kind of music do you hear? Because I know that your parents are musicians, so I think you were aware about the music since you were little child.
Mm-hmm.
But how was the real contact with music for you as an artist? Was it in Moscow or in New York?
Well, both are very musical places. When I was little and in Moscow, I listened to a lot of classical music and a lot of the Beatles and then a lot of Russian bards. And then when I moved to New York, then I started listening to everything else.
Was it difficult in that time in Russia to have this access to things like the Beatles, for example? I read that you're also a huge fan of Billie Holiday.
Yes,
Do you hear Billie Holiday
there? Billie Holiday I only heard in America already.
Until you get to the States.
In Soviet Russia, it was really hard to get any kind of Western music. So we had the Beatles, we had Queen, we had Moody Blues, because my dad was really into collecting tapes, and kind of there was this underground scene of a lot of people trading tapes and getting music and sharing it that way.
And you used to have a piano there?
Yeah.
Or how was the first contact with music, you playing it?
Well, my mom and my dad had this beautiful little upright piano, Petrov. It's a Czech company, actually. And it was really great, but then we moved, and so for a little while we didn't have one. But I think that if you really try hard, you can always find a place to practice, and lots of people have them in their house.
Yeah, and then you went to New York, everything changed, obviously, and then you start studying and playing classical music.
I started already in Russia. I started studying classical music when I was 7, and then in America, in the move, in the immigration, I missed about a year, and then I got a really amazing teacher in the Bronx where I moved to in New York, and then she taught me until I was 17.
And I imagine that you met there like new genres, like, I don't know, rock, hip hop, more styles besides classical music.
Yeah, I mean, I think that in New York, even if you don't, in some ways, I wasn't exposed to a lot of music because I grew up really poor, and it was before the internet, so you had to have money for a record collection, and I didn't buy any records ever. So in some ways, I was really limited. But in other ways, I think in New York, you just, by living there, you hear so much music. You hear music coming out of people's cars, you hear it in the stores, you hear it on television and on the radio. And so I was really exposed to everything. We had tons, and our neighborhood was just so many different races and different, people, immigrants from many different places. So, you listen to everything from, Indian music to like Latin music to all kinds of things.
Billie Holiday.
And Billie Holiday, yeah.
What's the thing with Billie Holiday? I mean, it's like when I see Billie Holiday's career, or maybe some other women from the 40s and the 50s, like Bessie Smith, maybe, and I hear your music, I think there is a connection.
Yeah, I really love the two women you mentioned.
I'm a huge fan of Bessie Smith.
I love Bessie Smith.
I was hearing Bessie Smith before the interview.
Yeah, she's amazing, and it was both those women had absolutely difficult, tragic lives. But the first time I really heard Bessie Smith and Billie Holiday and Ella Fitzgerald and a lot of jazz was when I went to college to study music, and we had really good classes that had like history of recorded music, things like that. So you just listen to a lot of early, Robert Johnson, a lot, a lot of blues and jazz.
I love all the Mississippi Delta blues. Yeah.
Yeah. So I heard that for the first time when I was 18, and it was just,
it really changed your life. Always,
yeah,
I think.
I think so.
Well, when I just visited like a few months ago the Mississippi Delta blues from New Orleans to Memphis, passing through Jackson and Clarksdale, and it is amazing. I mean, you learn a lot of new things about music and about the history of the rock and roll and a lot of genres.
Yeah, and I don't know if it's like that for you, but when I was there for the first time, just being there physically, you start to, just the nature there and the weather and everything, it feels like the music sounds. So I think that you can, I think that happens with a lot of music, that the first time you hear it, if you hear it somewhere in another country, it's one thing. It's just like listening to Edith Piaf before you've been to Paris.
Totally.
And
totally.
Then you get there and
yeah,
then
it changed everything. It,
you start to hear it in a new way.
Yeah. And one of the things that I was shocked was this museum about the blues in Clarksdale, where Morgan Freeman has all, the owner of a restaurant and what's the name of the place? Zero. The Zero, it's a place for blues and all the stuff. But one of the things that shocked me was this thing from Led Zeppelin saying, we owe everything to the Mississippi Delta blues. If you can say that, I mean, with the sound, maybe who could be the one, or who could be, which kind of artist?
I think there's too many. I don't have one specific thing. Definitely tremendous amounts with classical
music.
Is there
a record, an album that maybe changed you the way that you
too many,
do your music?
Too many did. Yeah. You know, it's I think that too many, there's, I'm a, you know, like, it's just too many influences. I can't ever pick one. So.
Yeah, and since you became from classical music and then meet this amazing story with American music, I imagine that you are very open to. Do you hear Mexican or Latin American music?
Oh, yeah, tons. Yeah? Tons in New York, yeah. And, you know, I think that Even on this tour, because I've been touring South America for the first time just now, so I got to, you know, we went to a tangueria in Argentina and got to hear, you know, live tango, and I'd never heard that before. There's so many things that I'd heard before, but not in the country where it's, you know, from. So hopefully, you know, at the festival, I'll get to hear some Mexican music in Mexico.
Where do you live in New York? In Brooklyn? Or
I'm not going to tell you.
Oh, no, no. Well, I will stalk you. Well, let me come visit you. And in the meanwhile, we are going to a commercial break.
Okay.
Okay. Vamos a un corte. Regina Spector está aquí en la casa. Voy a ver si la convenzo. De regreso con Regina Spector. So that's the address. I have it. Thank you. I will visit you and stalk you.
You could visit.
Okay, thank you. And what about the songwriting? The first songs that you wrote, I imagine that it's a little bit difficult to open, your mind, your heart, and then to fill an empty white paper.
Well, the thing is, I don't write on paper, so that I don't have to deal with the pressure.
I'm very romantic. Do you notice that?
Yeah. By candlelight, with ink, I'm, you know, my fingers are blue.
So
like,
you do
like Mozart, you know.
All the songwriting in Word.
It's, you know, it's all in, most of it is in my head and
okay.
And at the piano and, but I think yeah, in the beginning, I think it just was hard to write songs because I came from classical music, so, you know, I didn't really grow up like playing around on the piano things that weren't written by great composers. And then when you go from playing great composers to try and write something of your own, it's going to be very bad in comparison, especially in the beginning. And, you know, early songs they're really, really bad. But
you don't like them at all.
You know, I like them that because without them, I think I would never write music. So I'm very glad they existed because I think if you don't make, I think making something bad is better than not making anything at all because then you have the potential to get better. And if you just don't do it because, and there are tremendous amount of, you know, artists, painters, writers, musicians who make nothing. They're artists inside, but they don't produce any art
yes.
because they were afraid of that moment to start and make bad things.
Or even you can be a really good musician but never compose anything.
Yeah, well, that's different because I think composition it's a specific thing. But there are a lot of people that have talent and they just are afraid to do something with it because they're afraid to go through that bad stage where it's like. You're doing the thing, but you're doing it badly. And so I'm really glad that those songs exist because they were very bad, but I think that I would just have done nothing then if they didn't exist.
But I think now you are not afraid, of course, because you can write about literary characters and you can write about a wallet with a Blockbuster card. I mean, you're very open in your stories.
Yeah, well, because they are stories, so it's fun.
Where do you find those stories?
Everywhere. A lot of influence is from
true cases.
No, more imagination, I'd say. But things.
The Blockbuster is true.
a lot of it is just kind of imagination mixed with certain things that maybe there's a lot of things that you see in New York, and then also a lot of books, films. Pretty much anything.
I read an interview of you in Pitchfork Media about that album and about that song with Blockbuster, and they told you, like, are you aware that Blockbuster is broke, and how will be that in the story? Maybe the kids won't know what is exactly Blockbuster.
I know. Well, when I listen to old songs, like old jazz standards, there are certain words I have no idea what those things are.
Because, yeah, a lot of references that you don't know.
Yeah, like I didn't. Yeah, like certain things that were just typical to the culture in the 20s or the 40s that we don't have.
How do you decide who collaborates with you? I mean, in the last album, you have four producers of all kind of bands, of sounds.
Yeah.
And then you have a band. And I imagine that as you are a composer that works on her own, it's a little bit difficult maybe to get a band together.
Well, it's difficult just in the fact that, like, I have so many specific ideas and... And sometimes it's hard to find, when you have it in your head and you're trying to get it into real life. I mean, I think that happens to everybody, like people who make films. I'm sure it happens to people who work on this show. You have a certain idea and then you try to make it real. And when you bring it into real life, it changes anyway. So
become something else.
Yeah, and sometimes it's for the better and sometimes it's for the worse. But you have to just... You know, you still have to try. But I think that most importantly, I like collaborators that listen, you know, and that are...
You're a good listener also?
I try to be. Sometimes I'm not. It depends. It depends on what day you get me.
The thing is that with producers, you have to be very open.
Yeah, but the producers that I like to work with, they're very open too. So I think that I basically think that if two people work together and they don't have a lot of ego, like you really accept that you both want the best thing, but that for example, in when I work on music, at the end of the day, I only like to work with people who will let me have the final word because it's my music. So it has to be somebody who is very open and also very okay with them just having me go, no, you know, this is how it is, you know, because it's only because it's my music. I'm not like that when I work with people on their music. Like when I help people produce things or when I help arrange, I'm not like that. I'm only like that with my own stuff.
It's like the marriage when the men's, we said like, yeah, we have the final word. Do you know where it is? Yes.
Yeah, well, pretty much like that.
Thanks a lot for being here on the
thank
show.
Thank you.
Can you play more for us?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Regina Spector, Regina Spector, aquí en la casa.
Your stitches are all out, but your scars are healing wrong. And the helium balloon inside your room has come undone. And it's pushing up at the ceiling, and a flickering light, it cannot get beyond. Oh, everyone takes turns, now it's yours to play the part. And they're sitting all around you, holding cards. feels a little worse. When we drove our hearse right through that screaming crowd, while laughing up a storm until we were just bone, until it got so warm that none of us could sleep. And all the styrofoam began to melt away. We tried to find some worms to aid in the decay, but none of them were whole inside their catacomb. A million ancient bees began to sting our knees while we were on our knees praying that the disease would leave the ones we love and never come again. And on the radio we heard November Rain. My solo's real long, but it's a pretty song. We listened to it twice, but the DJ was asleep. This is how it works. You're young until you're not. You love until you don't. You try until you can't. You laugh until you cry. You cry until you laugh. Inside yourself, you take the things you like and try to love the things you took, and then you take that love you made and stick it into someone else's heart, pumping someone else's blood and walking arm in arm. You hope it don't get hard, but even if it does, you'll just do it all again. And on the radio, you'll hear November Rain. That song's awful long, but it's a good refrain. You listen to it twice, 'cause the DJ is asleep. On the radio, on the radio, on the radio, uh-oh. On the radio, uh-oh. On the radio, uh-oh. On the radio, uh-oh. Oh, 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 oh. Gracias.
Bueno, estamos llegando ya al final del programa del día de hoy. Yo soy Alejandro Franco y les quiero agradecer muchísimo que nos hayan acompañado en este programa con esta invitada de lujo y también con estos músicos impresionantes que trajo y que nos brindó para esta sesión. Gracias de nueva cuenta a la gente que nos acompañó aquí, gracias a ustedes que nos siguieron en el programa del día de hoy. Yo me despido, pero antes los dejo con Regina Spektor.
One foot on the ground, and by protecting my heart truly, I got lost in the sounds I hear in my mind. All of these voices I hear in my mind, all of these words I hear in my mind, all of this music, and it breaks my heart, and it breaks my heart. And it breaks my heart. And it breaks my heart. Suppose I never ever met you. Suppose we never fell in love. Suppose I never ever let you kiss me so sweet and so soft. Suppose I never ever saw you. Suppose you never ever called. Ooh. Suppose I kept on singing love songs just to pray. Just to break my fall.
protecting my heart. Truly, I got lost in the sounds I hear in my mind. All of these voices I hear in my mind. All of these words.
Smile.